Welcome to NeuroSociety Stories, a series created by the Dana Foundation that explores the incredible ways that neuroscience is shaping society. Through engaging conversations, we invite Dana Foundation grantees, partners, and other neuroscience and society thought leaders to share stories of discovery, innovation, and impact. Each episode offers unique perspectives on how brain science intersects with fields such as ethics, law, social sciences, and more, advancing neuroscience for the good of all. I'm Caroline Montojo, President and CEO of the Dana Foundation. Join us as we uncover how neuroscience can drive change, inspire new possibilities, and create a future that reflects the aspirations of all people. Mark. I am delighted to welcome Dr. Oliver Rollins, a sociologist and assistant professor of science, technology, and society at MIT. Oliver's work focuses on the sociological dimensions of neuroscience, and his recently published book is called Conviction: The Making and Unmaking of the Violent Brain. Just last year, Oliver spoke at the United Nations General Assembly, looking at how neuroscientific evidence and brain technologies are already being used in the courtroom. He's also a member of the Neurotech Justice Accelerator at Mass General Brigham, a Dana Center for Neuroscience and Society. Oliver, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Caroline. It's a pleasure.
Oliver, to start us off, I'd love to hear what inspired you to focus on this very unique intersection of sociology, neuroscience, and law.
I have a very interesting background, or unique background, I would say. So I started off as a biology major as an undergrad, and then ended up leaving biology, going into Pan-African studies. And with each step, I was adding on kind of these layers of where kind of I'm at today. After doing my master's in Pan-African studies, I did a PhD in medical sociology. And it was there where I was introduced to this area of science technology studies. My original focus was actually thinking about violence prevention. And as I was doing that work as a young graduate student, I was also taking classes on science technology studies. And one of the things that inspired me was my mentors doing work in genetics and really thinking about the relationship between genetics, society, and this question of race. And my original purpose of moving into thinking about the neurosciences was to just think about how does race impact the making of neuroscience in society in the same ways that they were thinking about genetics.
So did you major in biology?
I did.
Nice.
Yeah. So yeah. Like bio, black studies, then sociology,
medical
then
sociology.
Science.
Yeah.
I was bouncing around.
Okay, so you're like a prime example.
Yes.
What do you mean by interdisciplinary?
Right. Interdisciplinary, that's right.
Can you share with us why and how neuroscience might be useful for the law and for legal practitioners?
Yeah, so I think the biggest thing right now is the question around probably maturity, of brain maturity. And neuroscience, and this is kind of, you know, it's been a decade or so now, but neuroscience is, you know, weighed in on this question of brain maturity, which has actually impacted the courts in a way of thinking about juvenile sentencing. And so I think the people who have benefited the most have been juvenile courts, just being able to have kind of leeway to think about this question of maturity in relation to crime. So that's probably the biggest area. The second biggest area, I would say, would be questions around mental health. And really then bringing in neuroscience in conjunction with psychology to really think through these questions of mental health, which plays a huge role in the court system.
I'd also love to ask, what are the challenges and benefits of incorporating neuroscience evidence like brain scans into court cases? Can neuroscience evidence like this be used to reliably predict things like criminal intent or mental state?
The key question here is reliably. So in my book, I argue that it cannot right now. And mostly this has to do with the fact that many of the social factors that I find very important, like these larger systemic structural social factors, are just not taken up in the science right now, just not being brought into the models. And so when you ask questions around prediction and systemic injustices and what role does systemic injustice play with a young man or a young woman, in the way in which they interact with the law or they interact with the social justice system, it's just not there. So I think probably there's two big areas I would think about. One is what we call the group to individual problem. Within the scientific lab, you know, we're working with groups The comparisons are between groups, and when you go into the courts, we're talking about an individual, so an individual brain scan. And the second one would be a question around kind of systemic injustices or systemic power, I would say. When we're predicting or when you're trying to predict an individual and whether or not using brain scans, whether or not they would actually be a criminal or not, these models don't actually take into account things like systemic racism or systemic injustices.
Oliver, you are a member of the Neurotech Justice Accelerator at Mass General Brigham. This is a Dana Center for Neuroscience and Society. And one of the three pillars of focus in that center is on the intersection of neuroscience and law. Can you share with us about the work that you're engaged in there, what you're doing so far? In collaboration with Dr. Francis Shen and the folks at the Center for Law, Brain, and Behavior?
I mean, we're just getting started, as you know. I think one of the things we're probably really excited about, and the real focus here is training young individuals who both can speak the language and think about neuroscience and what's important about neuroscience, also be able to speak the language and think about what's important in the law, and have conversations with folks within society. So our big thing is really bringing folks together in a way to have these conversations, because what's been missing has been this conversation across. So if we really want to do something interdisciplinary, we really need to really be training folks in that way before they go out into the field. So really being able to bring those three areas together is the purpose of like our training.
I'm looking forward to continuing to follow the work from the Neurotech Justice Accelerator. That also made me think about all of these new students and early career scholars that you're training. And it's so interesting to think about how they are now able to be exposed to two different fields. Can you share a little bit about, you know, some advice you might have for them as they're navigating this career path that sort of falls between two different fields or incorporates two different fields?
A lot of things have changed, you know, where these paths weren't open when I was like a biology student trying to think through what did I want to do with a biology degree. And the biggest thing that helped me was keeping an open mind. So taking classes that were in the social sciences, taking classes within the humanities, and particularly right now in my field of science technology studies, is very interdisciplinary. And so the real point is to really be thinking interdisciplinary from a really early age and then being able to bring those questions and thoughts into your work along the time. I think the path will kind of open up, you know, with your interests in that way.
Sounds like you paved your own path, which also reminds me of my own pathway into this career, is thinking about bridging a lot of different fields together.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, both bridging things together that I wanted, but also some of the things that I thought were missing, you know, like some of the conversations I wanted to have in biology just weren't there. And so I was having to go into Black Studies to have those conversations. But then that was opening me up to a way of thinking about what do I bring with me into this new discipline. So I was bringing things from biology into Pan-African Studies, bringing things from those disciplines into sociology to help me rethink kind of the path that I wanted.
Yeah. All right. So keeping an open mind is absolutely critical when navigating these cross-disciplinary career paths.
That would be my advice.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Looking ahead now, what do you think are the most important next steps for the field of neuroscience and law?
I think we're at an interesting point in society right now, maybe a point where we can be rethinking the science that we want. And so there's probably two big things we can think about. And one is data governance, and particularly neurodata governance. As we have more and more neuroscience data that's being produced, how exactly are we going to govern that? And particularly, how are we going to govern it as it flows across like borders? So is it flowing from the US to Europe to Africa and things like that? And what's going to be the role of the law in adjudicating things like the ethics around this, particularly when we're thinking about how data is transforming, being very global now across the world? And the second piece will have to do with really thinking about how are we going to address these systemic injustices, right? So we already think about the criminal justice system as one impacted by systemic injustices. And what role can neuroscience actually play in helping us rethink that for the future?
Great. Thank you.